This week, I'm talking about hacking particle accelerators, essentially modifying powerful subatomic particle smashers to do weird and awesome things they weren't originally intended to do. Particle accelerators are machines that are capable of accelerating tiny subatomic particles to extreme speeds, 0 to 60,000 miles per hour in a fraction of a second, and then almost to the speed of light, using electric fields and magnets to steer and focus them. The most powerful particle accelerators, ones you've probably heard of like the Large Hadron Collider, are typically used to study the nature of the universe, recreating mini versions of things like black holes, supernovas, or even things similar to the Big Bang. So what do we do with all the old particle accelerators that can no longer keep pace with the new ones? Oftentimes, these are miles-long accelerators, huge amounts of infrastructure, and are actually too expensive to even demolish, so they end up just getting abandoned. But there's a growing trend to hacking these old particle accelerators to do unconventional things. Things like making movies of how photosynthesis works at the molecular level. This is happening at SLAC, a particle accelerator that was originally built to study the nature of protons and subsequently ended up discovering quarks. A few years ago, people hacked the particle accelerator at SLAC to do something new. For decades, particle physicists had been annoyed that electrons emit X-rays when they change direction. Somewhere along the way, people ended up figuring out, though, that these tiny little annoying X-rays that are nanometers in size could end up acting like tiny flashlights or tiny high-speed cameras in order to image things that are only nanometers in size. Wielding this new sort of accidental hack of electrons brought about an entirely new era that we live in today of X-ray lasers in the form of electron guns and wigglers, essentially things that cause the electrons to wiggle on purpose, thus emitting X-rays on purpose. These tiny controllable X-rays are what's enabling awesome new uses of particle accelerators, things like looking at photosynthesis and making movies of how photosynthesis actually works at an incredibly tiny level, which requires the collaboration between biologists and physicists, which is totally awesome because that's not something that happens all the time, and also really helping us understand how we might one day create artificial photosynthesis, which would be really useful. They may even be tapping into the plants, tapping into quantum entanglement in order to produce really efficient photosynthesis. So there's still a lot that we can learn about how photosynthesis happens and how we can apply it to our own uses. This technique of using tiny X-ray flashlights at SLAC is also being used to determine, actually confirm the likelihood that planets Neptune and Uranus produce diamond rain, which is incredibly awesome. By simulating the conditions of Neptune inside the accelerator, researchers could actually see the diamonds forming at the nanometer scale. Of course, on Neptune or Uranus, these diamonds are actually probably going to be millions of carats in weight, but it's still incredibly cool to be able to see it here on Earth. Similar techniques are also being used at the Swiss Light Source Particle Accelerator to get incredibly detailed 3D images of how a fly uses its muscles to flap its wings 50 times a second, which could be very useful if we ever want to create fly-mimicking little robots. Particle accelerators are increasingly being used to do interesting things like determine if there are paintings underneath paintings or find old operas from 200 years ago. And there are even more awesome things like the fact that the Louvre has a particle accelerator underneath it. Yeah, the Louvre in Paris, the museum in Paris, has a particle accelerator underneath it, and it uses it to get different information about artifacts at the museum, how old they are, and what they're made of. By directing a beam of cesium ions at an artifact, they can then see what atoms get ejected out as a result, and they can count how many unstable carbon atoms there are versus how many stable carbon atoms there are, and that ratio tells them how old the artifact is. Equally, during this process, looking for isotopes like beryllium-10 or aluminum-26 can also tell how long an artifact has been left out on the surface of the Earth, essentially exposed to cosmic rays. Cosmic rays regularly rain down on Earth's surface, and by looking for rare isotopes, we can determine how old, or not how old, but actually how long an artifact has been out on the surface of the Earth. This technique of looking for rare isotopes to determine how long things have been bombarded by cosmic rays is also helping us in looking at glacier history in Antarctica and Greenland and elsewhere. By looking at rocks that have been exposed to the surface, we can also see how long they've been exposed to the surface, because at one point they were covered by a glacier that was protecting them from cosmic rays. So from demystifying photosynthesis to recreating diamond rain inside of Neptune, to unlocking the mysteries of how a fly actually flies, to tracking the history of glaciers, these are just a few of the reasons that I think hacking particle accelerators is so incredibly exciting. Thanks so much for watching this week, Space Friends. Remember to subscribe on YouTube and actually check out the description this week. I'll be linking to a lot of the things that I mentioned in this video. And also remember to join Patreon, because I make these videos entirely by myself and your support helps a tremendous amount. Also, you can get sneak peeks of my work there and signed copies of my book.